Our next talk is the use of cutting-edge audio-visual technologies to communicate the contemporary relevance of Sri Guru Granth Sahib. And the author is Sundeep, fondly called as Bobby Singh Bedi. Bobby has received National Award for Best Film by the President of India twice. In 2016, he received a Lifetime Achievement Award by the Valladolid Film Festival in Spain. Apart from producing feature films and directing documentaries, Bobby designs and produces content for museums. These include Virasat-e-Khalsa at Anandpur Sahib, the Mahabharat Multimedia Gallery at Kurukshetra, the Bihar History Museum at Patna, and Baba Phagel Singh Museum at Mangla Sahib, New Delhi. I would now request Bobby Bedi to make a presentation.
They probably put me at that time as the entertainer. See, thousands of years of history have shown that whenever mankind has strayed into an undesirable space or life, there's been a need for correction. And some enlightened person takes the master's role and redefines the way of life. This redefined way of life soon converts into plain practice and then finally ritualism. We start following instructions in letter, not in spirit. Spirituality makes way for blind faith. Soon the cycle is complete, and there is again need for correction, so a new master takes charge. Krishna and Moses existed more than 4,000 years ago. Buddha and Mahavir were there 2,500 years ago. Then 500 years later, there was Christ. Some 4 centuries later, there was Muhammad. In that context, Sikhism is a very young religion. The 5 centuries that have elapsed since Guru Nanak walked upon this earth are but a blink of an eye in the history of man. Events happening at that time are well known. People who lived at that time are easily remembered. That was the time that Christopher Columbus stumbled upon America, that Vasco da Gama found the route to India, that Magellan completed the first voyage around the world. William Shakespeare was writing his plays, and his complete works were completed before the Guru Granth Sahib was compiled. So, I'm saying all this just to show how recent and how contemporary the Guru Granth Sahib is. I mean, it's more recent than Shakespeare, which we consider to be a very sort of standard text in our schools today. The beauty is that the writing is still with us in its original form. It's the only faith probably where we know that it's 100% authentic writing, and the record continues from the period it was written to now. If you, those of you who know North India or Delhi, the Lodhi tombs are from the time of Nanak's lifetime. If you go to Lodhi Garden, those tombs existed. Humayun, whose tomb is not far away, was battling to save his fledgling kingdom when Nanak passed into eternity. The Qutub Minar, in fact, had been already dominating Delhi skies for 2 centuries before Nanak was born. So this is the story of a very young religion. So our concerns are immediate, and the message of Sikhism is very fresh. So now I come to my current obsession and what I'm doing with this. I'm a filmmaker, I tell stories. Somehow got roped into telling this story and then became obsessed by it, and now it's the 4th or 5th different chapter in my life just on this process. So we set up something called the Mool Project. The word Mool we all understand from the Mool Mantra, which is the core, the root. And it stems from the belief that many of the values captured in our Gurbani are completely relevant today, and even today taught in schools in some form or the other. So the values that I have picked upon for this project, and this will continue to evolve in some entries later: secularism, gender equality, caring and sharing, the use of violence only for the defense of the defenseless, defending the defenseless, and lastly, deep respect for nature and environment. So the project that we've done targets two groups, both of whom perhaps do not understand Sikhism in its true form. The first and the most important one is the young Sikhs, our own children, my own children, your own children, where somewhere they have, I don't speak for everybody, but I'm speaking for the larger community and the kind of reaction I get, that there's a lot that has fallen between the ritualism and their lives. You know, and a lot of them are sort of begin to believe and redefine what a Sikh is and what a Sikh isn't. Today there's been a lot of clarity for people, but there are no young people here. So we decided that we talk to them in a different way. The other target audience for me is again, was very aptly brought out in the last presentation and in one earlier presentation with reference to America, but it's true for the whole world. Who is a Sikh? I mean, that understanding for the international community also is a very important one, especially in the sort of current confusion with Muslims. One shouldn't make that distinction, but the fact is that today a lot of Sikhs in America are getting confused, and I felt that if the Danish ambassador comes to India, is there a way that in 30 minutes I can tell him what this is all about? It's my job to tell stories. So these are my two target audiences. Now, the question was, how do we talk to these people? And I said, let's design it for the children, and then let the international community learn from that same experience. So I said, let's talk to them using their language, their aesthetics, and their technology. That's the only way that they are going to be actually understood. We've seen it before. You hand someone the Gita, the Bible, the Granth Sahib in any form. This generation is not going to either have the time, patience, language skills, and understanding skills to read and understand what's inside. I'm getting an echo. Yeah. So let's talk to them like we do normally. We've seen it with anything. There used to be comics, now there are animation films. There used to be novels, now there are feature films. But television has come up. So life keeps on evolving. So why aren't we evolving in our way of communicating what we believe are very essential messages to humanity and mankind, and especially to our children? So now I'm going to show you two examples of the kind of work that we're doing. And because what I'm showing has been designed for the immersive technology, because the place that we've actually finished building in New Delhi, right next to the Houses of Parliament, is a building that contains a dome for dome projection, a central space for holography, and you know, using modern technology like those 4DX chairs where you can feel the motion, smell the perfume, feel the breeze. So if you say Pavan Chavro Pare, Dhupa Malyanlo Pavan Chavro Pare, you will actually be able to experience the fragrance of sandalwood and the breeze on your face as the aarti plays out. So this has been slightly reformatted for playing on a flat screen, but you'll get a very good sense of it. I'm glad I chose these two examples because they've come up in several of the talks, and especially with Dr. Jaswal Singh, referred to first the aarti as the international anthem, and then to the dialogue, Sidh Ghosht, which is in the context of pluralism as well as of putting gods on pedestals, and ritualism, of course. So these two examples will cover these two points. The commentary that you're reading is written by a well-known writer, but in his profession, he's a diplomat, and he's our current ambassador to the United States, Navdeep Singh Sarna. He's done the commentary for this entire project. The voice that I've used for the English, which is what you're going to hear today, is again a very well-known and a beautiful voice that is Kabir Bedi. It's recognized internationally. And occasionally Kabir Bedi even appears as a hologram whenever we need to bridge gaps in presentations. we've used different singers, but the two shavas that you're going to listen to today as part of this are done by a very well-known pop singer called Jasbir Jassi, who's been very sort of prolific in his work on popular Punjabi music, but very few people know that he grew up as a party and doing kirtan in jathas around the villages that he lived in Gurdaspur. So his knowledge of Gurbani is very deep. We've used him. And interestingly, the final sound mixing and the final production of the music, etc., that we're doing is happening in Los Angeles with somebody of Indian origin called Jeff Bhaskar, who's won several Grammys and is producing some of the most famous music today. So the whole process is totally international. And we're also hopeful that once this project is complete in Delhi, we're completely willing to share it as a foundation to anyone who wants it, as long as they can create some local way of showing it or screening it or whatever. We will happily reformat and give it for their use. So now if you give me just a second to connect my machine. This is designed for a 360, so it will finally look nicer on Google Glass or something. But
once I journeyed to the Guru and his companion Mardana to the Jagannath temple in Puri, in Odisha. As the Guru and Mardana camped near the temple, the priests were performing the evening prayer, the Aarti. They held beautiful salvers in their hands, decorated with earthen lamps and flowers and incense. They swayed from side to side as they sang melodious hymns to the accompaniment of bells and conches. It was a beautiful ceremony, but Guru Nanak was unmoved. To him, this was not prayer. It was merely ritual. When the priests expressed their anger, the Guru explained to them that the true worship of the Creator was being performed by the very elements of the universe, the sky and the stars, the sun and the moon, the forests and the wind, accompanied by the music of creation. Is the salver. The sun and moon are the lamps. The stars in heaven are the pearls. The fragrance of sandal is the incense. Fanned by the winds, all for thee, the great forests and fields of flowers. Oh, what a beautiful aarti is being performed for you, O destroyer of fear. Universe had already been written.
This will be as a holograph in the center.
So when I went to see of this celestial army, it went on, translated in Bengal. Just as Bhutan believed that the true worship of the Creator would be performed by nature, he did not believe that the path to God involved renunciation or in trees, forests, and mountains. A true path to God meant living righteously in the world, adhering to the core values that Guru Nanak preached, and meditating on the true name. This message is best illustrated by his discussion on Mount Sumer, also known as Mount Kailash, with 84 siddhas or ancient sages who had meditated long and deep and possessed great power and wisdom. Guru Nanak and the siddhas had a spiritual debate. They inundated him with many questions and argued that it was not possible to be part of the world and follow the path of meditation and spirituality. Guru Nanak responded, "Like the lotus is untouched by water, and a duck swimming against the current stays dry, similarly, with divine utterances in our mind and repeating his name on our lips, we cross the tempestuous ocean of the world."
Just as the lotus can exist, a beautiful flower can exist in the filth of the pond and in normal life, so shall you as spiritual leaders be amongst your people, amongst our subjects, rather than live in that exalted space that God is creating. So this is the approach we are following, and we are going through the entire history of Sikhism, all the way from the first guru up till the Ranjit Singh's empire. And in the context of bringing out those shabads and that part of Gurbani that specifically relates to the core values that we are promoting. That's really what the whole foundation is about, and I thought it would be a good place to talk to about it. Thank you. Any questions? Translating this into all the languages of the United Nations apart from Punjabi.
So, Mool project, there is a question here. Mool project is a great medium to reach the audience to share. Can you share your perspective why Nanak Shah?
Fakir?
Nanak Shah. Is that what you meant?
Yes.
See, it's difficult to comment on somebody else's work. A film is a very, very unique sort of a thing, and very few of them ultimately end up working. And it's to do with when it's marketed, how it's done. And there was a lot of controversy of it, and from within the community itself, there was a lot of opposition to it in principle rather than in, and as you see, even in our case, if Nanak is projected, he's projected entirely as a static image, because the belief is that no real character can play Nanak or Muhammad or even Buddha. So these are the kind of constraints that come up, and you have to fight them with creative ways of doing it. Why something fails, I don't know. It's very difficult to ask that.
Do you have a question?
If you have something you can share with us, is it suitable for flattening and not cleaning or something?
See, suitable as in for now or?
Yeah, now if you have something.
No, this is all designed for a spherical screen. But I mean, we can, it will show on the flat screen. This desktop, we were not getting the perfect sound and projection, but it works on a flat screen. If we get the technology sorted out, it will work.
My question will be, where is this Moon project being implemented in Delhi? In what location?
We've got a fantastic location for it. I mean, if you know Delhi, we are at the roundabout where the Kaukaj Road starts, so we are right next to Parliament, with this entrance from the same side that you entered Parliament from. So it is in the most prestigious real estate of New Delhi, and we expect that it will become a sort of very visible landscape, mark on the landscape of Delhi.
What's the timeline on this?
The building is ready. The construction is done. Now we are doing the interiors and the pavement. I would realistically think middle of next year is when it will be inaugurated. Like I said, we are happy to share the content with anybody who wants it. And format it for flat, round, that's a very easy part of technology. The question.
You mentioned about the platform that you'd be willing to share with anybody who wants to pursue similar content. What form will that take? Is it the technology to show content, to create content?
See, very interestingly, one thing that we are doing on our own is that we will recreate this content for technologies like Oculus and Google Glass. So that you can actually be able to download it and experience it within your own little environment. But yes, I mean, I've been approached by a couple of gurdwaras and centers across the world. Singapore is one of them. It says, we have the space, what can you do? And I tell them that, no, you can put up the dome, you can, or you want to put up an auditorium, or you want to put up small 3D boxes or whatever, we can give you the content. You deal with yourself, the cost, and we'll make sure that you have the market from us for free. It depends on who will need it. I mean, the whole idea is to share it as much as we can.
Thank you so much. That's great work. I just had a quick question. I wanted to get your views as a filmmaker on, you know, our reluctance as a community, like you said, to portray our gurus in visual medium. And I just wanted to know your thoughts about it. What do you think? I mean, if it's appropriate or not. And why do you think that as a community we are not evolved enough to make a distinction that that's an artist playing the guru and focus on the message instead of so much opposition for any movie or audiovisual material coming out that says, oh, he's portraying the guru, it cannot be shown. I think this is like a stumbling block before we even start the race.
So I think that I think it's a very misplaced sense of protection in doing so. I think whatever, I mean, I genuinely believe that this is not what Guru Nanak would have wished, what I don't know. But if we can get the message across, if we can get it across properly, then all stories are told by characters. And I would personally have no objection to it. But at the same time, there's no sense in creating a message if the receiver is not ready to receive it. So until the community is in a position to receive happily this kind of content, it'll keep failing.
But I think if your content is for people who are not Sikhs, otherwise you're preaching to the crowd. If you want to spread the message, then why not do it through a character? Because you are saying you're limited.
No, I'm okay to do it, but there's no sense in my doing something which, if people are not going to accept it, then how on earth am I going to be able to show it? It's not a cheap process.
I have a small suggestion or question, whatever you may pick it as. If you can produce this set of DVDs for young children, school-going children, for example, we have Khalsa school here, and I'm sure many Gurdwaras in the world have classes for the young children. If you have a set of, produce a set of DVDs which can be distributed all over the world in Sikh Gurdwaras at least, which can be shown to the children, it's a very interesting way to teach children about the basics of Sikhism, Sikh history.
See, it's like this, that children today are very, very, very sensitive to what you preach to them. If you tell them this is to educate you and teach you, then the battle is lost before you even start fighting. You have to be able to make engaging content. Education without engagement today is just, it can happen at the PhD level maybe. But today, even if you look at a simple chemistry book, and we were very happy to see formulae and diagrams in chemistry books. Today, every single experiment is supported by high quality video content. So, it's got to be disguised, and that is what we are doing. I mean, you've seen two things here. We are showing you Sakhis, we are showing you the Malik Bhago story for the children. But the idea is to show it in such a way that when they go home, they think that, okay, wow, I mean, the Gagan mein thal, Ravichand, Deepak, but now you're talking about nature and environment at a time when theoretically it should not have been an issue. But it was, they were conscious of it. Pavan Guru, Pani, Pita, Mata, Dhat, Mata, you're talking about that kind of thing, you're talking about nature and environment, and you talk it in that language and that word, and then when the child goes home, they will have received a message, and if 30-40% of that message is retained in their mind, it's likely to be a lot more successful. Then, I mean, I'll give you the experiment with Anand Prasad. One of the reasons that I got very enthused about this was after we did the Virasat Khalsa at Anand Prasad. I don't know if anybody had actually been there or not, but it's a building designed by Moshe Safdi. Moshe Safdi is in the US Congress building. He's a Boston Harvard based architect. He's in the Holocaust Museum in Jerusalem. He's in Singapore Marina Sands. He's one of the world's top three or four leading architects, and that's his best building. It's a piece of art, it's on 120 acres of land. So it is a complete joy doing content for that. But we've done songs, we've done music, we've done Gurbani, we've done a whole Ekamkar installation with crystal beads and resonating voices. People actually just come there and sit down and meditate. They feel that overwrought by that installation. So we used to think that, when I first did that job, I was just commissioned to do it. But we are getting 7,000 people a day, on weekends per day, and 4,000 to 5,000 people on weekdays, 6 days a week, one day it is shut. And that's been going on for 4 years, and that's when I realized that when you communicate now, you must communicate with higher standing. And and there were some critics, they said that, oh, this is because it's next to Anand Prasad. Till we realized that the Anand Prasad Golak had doubled in the period that the museum had happened. And although it was for free, people were still throwing money in the boxes over there and in the pond over there and whatever was happening. So I think time has changed. I mean, you have to communicate to people in their language, their technology, their aesthetic, and whatever message you want to give has to be contained within that. If you talk directly, it's not going to happen. I mean, that's my belief.
Thank you for your effort and made a difference to our community and our religious. My request is, I'm a Santhagar County Board member, the health department, and also I'm a housing commissioner and art commissioner. What we do, also I forgot to mention, advisory committee for all the nationality. What I'm trying to see, we are very much well known in this temple. We had on Sunday, there's a street change name. So how we can convince other people to believing in our effort? They are coming in, we bring all the political leaders here, even Gordon did the opening, so we were well known. But myself, it's hard to convince sometimes. I was making a speech over at South Carolina University, 500 people showed up, and tell me where you get this. I got it from the Guru Granth Sahib, and I translate, no word from me. So that means what we have is a unique. There's no way we can trade that. We need to follow it, but myself, it's hard for us. We don't have the knowledge and experience to get there. Thank you for your service and effort, and I do thank you for the organizer. Thank you.
Once again, thank you very much for your presentation. I'm very much interested in getting the content from you. Can you tell us how we get that? And then I have a follow-up question.
See, as the content will get ready, the foundation and the committee that's commissioned the project will work out a way of how you have to get the content and what reformatting it needs. Because you're not going to be able to put in every place the $4 or $5 million that it's taken us as to building installation against the land. But I am looking at it for flat screens, I am looking at it for Oculus, I'm looking at it. I mean, after this is done, I can show you what it actually looks like on my iPad and you'll get a sense of what this is. We were not able to do justice on the projection. But I mean, once it's done, we'll find that way out.
Okay. The other question is, are you going to build something that we can present to a non-Sikh Punjabi audience here or in different countries where we can spread the message?
This whole piece, which will be about 40, 45 minutes, is designed for any human being and to entertain them. So, I mean, my target is literally, is there, if the Norwegian or the Danish ambassador comes to Delhi, we're right next to Parliament. I think if our external affairs ministry says, sir, come here for half an hour, and you will understand Sikhism. In 30 minutes, he will know about the history, the value systems, and who we are. And that same thing can happen here without any issue.
Thank you very much, Babaji, for an excellent talk and introducing us to the exciting audiovisual projects underway to help introduce message of Sikhi to our next generation as well as to the non-Sikhs. So thank you, thanks a lot. So I think with that, this session comes to an end, and the good news is we are on time. And we can have a 20-minute break and meet at 3:55 on schedule. Thank you.